Good evening.
Good evening.
And welcome to the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research. This is a school and not a church. Neither are we affiliated with any religious organization. This school is a non-profit, non-denominational, religious, and scientific research organization dedicated to show proof of the existence of Yahweh Elohim and the operation of the eternal purpose, pattern, and plan operating throughout eternity into this present day. This school was established as a result of a divine vision and revelation given to our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley, in the state of Ohio in the year of 1931. We were incorporated into the state of California in the year of 1958. Since that time, we have established branch schools throughout the United States and Canada in certain foreign countries. The Ontario branch was established in May of 1988. Now, in this school, we teach by the true and correct name and title for the Father, the Word, our Son, and the Holy Spirit, as contained in the original Hebrew text. The true and correct name for the Father is Yahweh. It has been improperly substituted by Lord. The true title for the Word or Son is Elohim. It has been improperly substituted by God. The name of the Holy Spirit, manifested in our physical body, is Yahshua. It has been erroneously substituted by Jesus Christ. Lord and God are titles and not names. The Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8 and 5 that they're Lord's men and God's men. But we now know each Lord must have a name and each God must have a name also. Elohim is a title, but unlike Lord and God, Elohim is a divine title. This means Elohim is the title that our Creator chose for Himself. Jesus is a name, but it is an erroneous name. On my investigation on your part into a good dictionary or encyclopedia will prove that neither the Hebrew language, the Greek language, nor the Latin language have any letters or alphabets in their language that will produce the sound that is made by this letter J. Neither was there a letter J in the English language to some 1400 years after the Messiah's death. Therefore, such names as Jesus and Jehovah are impossible renderings for the true and correct name of our Father and His Son. Christ is a title just like Lord and God. Now Yahweh is pure spirit, and in this state He is inscrutable and incomprehensible and indiscernible. He is the ultimate source, substance, limits, and bounds of all things. We have Yahweh in His pure spirit state, symbolized on this chart as a fiery cloud. Yahweh in pure spirit is not a cloud. He merely chose a cloud to symbolize Himself, because a cloud has no particular or descriptive shape and form. Just as you see, this fiery cloud has been drawn to its stem all around the edge of this chart to show you that everything on this chart abides within this cloud. In like manner, everything in the creation and the sum total of the universe abides within the pure spirit state of Yahweh. Yahweh, knowing that man could not perceive of Him in this pure spirit state, took on shape and form within Himself as Elohim. This is the Word or Son. A supernatural being, that is, having the shape and form of a man, but without flesh and blood. This form can only be seen in divine visions and understood in divine revelation. Later on, this self-same spirit manifested himself in a physical body and walked the earth plane as Yahshua the Messiah, whom the world calls Jesus Christ. Now there's only one name given unto salvation, and we must know that name. So the simple yet intelligent question we should ask ourselves is, what was the name of the Savior during the time he walked the earth plane? A further understanding of this name and title may be had by reading the preface to the Holy Name Bible. Also in this school, we teach by the divine pattern of the universe. It is called a divine pattern because it is Yahweh's pattern. After Yahweh led the children of Israel out of Egypt, he called Moses atop Mount Sinai and showed him the tabernacle pattern in a vision. He instructed Moses to build one exactly like it in the wilderness of Sinai. This pattern consists of a most holy place, a holy place, and a court round the light. These three compartments make up your one tabernacle pattern. We go forth in this school to show proof how that everything in the universe is made and operates according to the structure and function of this threefold tabernacle pattern, and that absolutely nothing escapes the pattern. The primary constitutional aims and objectives of the Institute are as follows. First is to help you find and know Yahweh or Elohim as he really is and actually exists. Second, it's to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua the Messiah without distinction of race or nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. Third, it's to investigate the unexplained spirit law by the so-called laws of nature and the powers latent in man. Fourth, is to encourage and promote the study of the scriptures, comparative religion, psychology, philosophy, and modern practical and occult science. Fifth is to extirpate current superstition, skepticism, and ignorance. Sixth is to learn, know, and understand the operation of Yahweh's eternal purpose through the dispensations and ages. Seventh is to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, the devil, the dragon, or Satan and his demons operating amidst their iniquity on earth through the dispensation of time. Eighth is to earnestly contend for the common salvation and faith which was once delivered unto the sons or children of Yahweh. Ninth is to make known that Yahweh from the beginning ordained, there is no other name given among men whereby man can be saved, save in the name of Yahshua the Messiah. And tenth is to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua the Messiah with the hope of immortal glorification in the new earth state. Our watchword is peace, and our slogan is speak the truth. We have a prayer this evening by Dr. Bud Wunsch in a scripture lesson of Matthew, the 24th chapter, by Dr. Irene Ramirez.
Let's bow in our hearts and minds. Father, we are most grateful for this opportunity you have given us to be here in our right minds, knowing that you, the Almighty, are the Creator of everything that we can see and feel and touch. We are extremely grateful that you have chosen us to be brought into this teaching, from the billions of people that could be here, we are the ones that you have called. We ask that you lead and guide us to do those things that are pleasing in your sight. And let's all say,
Amen.
Before the scripture, we have another song.
There you go.
You know the pause?
Mm-hmm.
Huh?
Yes, sir.
We can talk it first. Yes. Oh, okay.
Yeah. There we go.
Okay.
Yeah.
I'll be reading Matthew 24 chapter in the Millennium Bible. No, it's okay. I'm sure. And Yahshua went out and departed from the temple, and his disciples came to him to show him the building of the temple. And Yahshua said unto them, See ye not all these things? Verily I say unto you, there shall not be left one here, one stone upon another, that shall not be thrown down. And as he sat upon the Mount Olives, the disciples said unto him privately, saying, Tell us, when shall these things be? And what sign shall be, and what shall be the signs of thy coming, and the end of the age? And Yahshua answered and said unto them, Take heed that no man deceive you, for many shall come in my name, saying, I am the Messiah, and shall deceive many. And ye shall hear of wars and rumors of wars. See that ye be not troubled, for all these things must come to pass, but the end is not yet. For nation shall rise against nation, kingdom against kingdom, and there shall be famines and pestilence, earthquakes in various places. All these things are the beginning of plagues. Then shall they deliver you up to be afflicted, and shall kill you, and ye shall be hated of all the nations for my name's sake. And then shall many be offended, and shall betray one another, and shall hate one another. And many false prophets shall rise, and shall deceive many. And because of hypocrisy shall abound, the love of many shall grow cold. But he that shall endure it to the end, the same shall be saved. And the glad tidings of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world for a witness unto all the nations, and then shall the end come. When ye therefore shall see the abomination of desolation spoken of by Daniel the prophet, stand in the holy place. Whosoever readeth, let him understand. And let them which be in Judea flee into the mountains. Let him which is on the housetop not come down to take anything out of his house. Neither let him which is in the field return back to take his clothes. And woe unto them that are with child, and to them that give suck in those days. But pray ye that your flight be not in the winter, neither on the Sabbath day. For then shall be great tribulations, such as was not since the beginning of the world to this time, nor ever shall be. And except those days be shortened, there shall no flesh be saved. But for the elect's sake, those days shall be shortened. And if any man shall say unto you, Lo, here is the Messiah, or there, believe it not. For there shall arise false messiahs and false prophets, and shall show great signs and wonders, insomuch that if it were possible, they shall deceive the very elect. Behold, I have told you before. Wherefore, if they shall say unto you, Behold, here is in the desert, he is in the desert, go not forth. Before, he is in the chamber, the secret chamber, believe it not. For as the lightning cometh out of the east, and shineth even into the west, so shall also the coming of the Son of Man be. Mm-hmm. For wheresoever the carcass is, there will the eagles be gathered together. Immediately after tribulations of those days shall the sun be darkened, and the moon shall not give her light, and the stars shall fall from the heavens, and the powers of the heavens shall be shaken. And then shall appear the sign of the Son of Man in heaven, and then shall all the tribes of the earth mourn, and they shall see the Son of Man coming in the clouds of heaven, and power and great glory. And he shall send his angels with a great sound of trumpets, and they shall gather together his elect from the four winds, from one end of the heavens to the other. Now learn a parable of the fig tree. When its branch is yet tender and putteth forth leaves, ye know that the summer is nigh. So likewise, ye, when ye shall see all these things, know that it is near, even at the door. Verily I say unto you, that generations shall not pass till all these things be fulfilled. Heaven and earth shall pass away, but not my words shall pass away. But of the day and hour knoweth no man, no, not the angels of heaven, but my Father only. But as the days of Noah were, so shall also the coming of the Son of Man be. For as in the days that were before the flood, they were eating and drinking, marrying and giving up marriages, until the day that Noah entered into the ark, and knew not until the flood came and took them all away, so shall also the coming of the Son of Man be. Then shall two be in the field, and one shall be taken, and the other left. Two grinding the mill, and one shall be taken, and the other left. Watch therefore, for ye know not what the hour your king doeth come. But know this, that if the good man of the house had known in what watch the thief would come, he would have watched, and would not have suffered his house to be broken up. Wherefore be ye also ready, for inasmuch an hour as ye think not the Son of Man cometh. Who then is a faithful and wise servant, whom his master hath made ruler over his household, to give them bread in the due season? Blessed is that servant whom his master, when he cometh, find him so doing. Verily I say to you, that he shall make him ruler over all his goods. But if the evil servant shall say in his heart, My master delayeth his coming, and shall begin to smite his fellow servant, and to eat and to drink and with the drunken, the master of that servant shall come in the day he looketh not for him, and in an hour that he is not aware of him, and shall be cut him asunder, and appoint him his portion with the hypocrites. There shall be weeping and gnashing of the teeth. Mm-hmm. That's Matthew 24 chapter of Matthew. Let's all say, hallelujah.
Before our first speaker, I forgot to tell the sound man there's 9 tracks on that tape. So he played one over again. But yeah, I didn't tell him there's 9 tracks on that tape. So we'll hear different music. Yeah, next time, started too. And at this time, we'll have a testimony by Sister Siobhan England.
She's also a doctor.
Doctor? Mm-hmm. Well, she's not a doctor here until you go 1 year. Then she's a double doctor.
That's right.
I say Johnny. Huh? Her. I said her.
Her, yeah. Dr. Siobhan Lincoln.
Yeah.
Yeah, well, Dr. Siobhan, yeah. Yeah. Well, after you're here a year, you get a doctor's license here.
PhD, master's.
Yeah. I got a master's degree, too.
Is she a medical doctor? Medical doctor?
We all got masters.
No, I know that, but...
Yeah, who's smarter than us?
Is she a medical doctor?
If you don't want to, you don't have to. I just wanted to know if you wanted to. I'm going to give you that opportunity. If you don't want to give a testimony, you don't have to. You can let me know, say, hey, Reggie, I'm ready now. It's cool with me. It's cool with everybody here.
That's right.
Okay? That's entirely up to you. That's entirely up to you. You're not ready yet. You're not ready. It's okay. No problem. Just let me know when you want to give a testimony. And I'll be glad to put you up here. Our first speaker will be the dean of the school, Dr. Joe Williams.
Good evening, class.
Good evening.
I'm happy to be here, and especially on a Friday night, it's the place to be.
Yes.
But I will say this. Everybody should have a reasonable testimony. Mm-hmm. And it might not have been a fair time to call you first. But what a testimony basically is, you know, if you want to expound, you can. If you choose not to, that's okay. Mm-hmm. But it's something in your heart that expressed to the body, to edify, to inspire by why you here, why you stay here, why you continue to come on a regular, consistent basis. Mm-hmm. Now I'm going to give a quick testimony about myself before I get into teaching. Mm-hmm. Now, just to give an idea about what a testimony is all about. Now, when I first came to the school, I was 16 years old. Mm-hmm. And I was actually taking a religious class. I was studying different religions in high school. Mm-hmm. And I called myself a so-called learned man. Learned about a little about Judaism, about Seventh-day Adventists, Jehovah's Witness, Christianity, Buddhism, and all that stuff. You know, the Hare Krishnas and all that. Got into that. And it just so happened my father invited me to come to a class. So I come with my notebook and my little notes and everything, pencils and everything. And we sit there, and I heard Dr. Harris get on the floor. Mm-hmm. And he gave a good lecture. The name Yahweh, I saw the charts, I thought, what is my dad getting into? You see, he got up there and explained the charts, and that was great. And I didn't go back for 4 years. And the reason I didn't go back to class, because I saw Dr. Kenny get up. And as he was walking, looked like he's about to croak over. And my dad tapped me on the leg and said, hey, that's God right there. Mm-hmm. I said, oh, he must be off his rocker, if that's God. Now, the reason why I said that is because I had a concept about what God is and how God should look.
Right. Mm-hmm.
I had no idea, you see, that God is a man. It just didn't occur to me.
Yeah.
Not a physical man walk around looking like he's about to croak over.
Yeah.
You see?
Yeah.
However, I started getting to conversations with my father about the teaching, because I was caught up in Islam. And I was one of those guys running around here thinking that white people are white blue-eyed devils. Mm. It didn't matter how good they were. Mm. And so what happened was, when I was in high school, college, Elijah Muhammad died. And I'm telling you right now, everybody in the dorm come knocking on my door. Mm-hmm. Say, Joe, what you gonna do now? Mm-hmm. Elijah Muhammad is dead. Or should I say Elijah Pooley, which was his real name. Mm-hmm. And what happened, it kind of touched my heart a little bit, because I was really caught up in it. I believe that women couldn't preach. Mm-hmm. And Islam was the only way to go. Mm-hmm. And in the Bible, where it talked about, and Elijah should come and turn the hearts of the father, the hearts of the sons of the father, the sons of the hearts of the father, and the father to the son. We would say, that's the only Elijah I see. I didn't know that that was John the Baptist at that time. Because somebody came along and showed me how to go into the scriptures and line them up by a pattern. Now, what I did was, I found myself getting to debates and arguments with my father about basic principles, about the teaching, about God, and those things. And I found myself using the same lingo or the vernacular that my father would use as he was trying to get me to see a principle. Mm-hmm. So when I went to explain it to somebody else, I was using the same vernacular. Mm-hmm. Do you follow what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. And I said to him, I found out, what am I doing? Let me go down to the school. And I never will forget it, about 4 or 5 years later. It was Palm Sunday, the week before Easter, 1977. I think it was April 13th at that time. Mm-hmm. Beverly Allen got on the floor. Mm-hmm. Yahweh had to choose a woman. Mm-hmm. That was for me. Mm-hmm. And Beverly Allen went through this teaching. She explained these charts. She showed me how, you see, Moses, you see, was down here in the land of Egypt. Mm-hmm. And how he came to the dividing waters of the Red Sea and into the wilderness. Mm-hmm. And how that Yahweh called Moses up into the mountain and showed him a rerun of the creation, how it came in by the pattern. Then she went on down and showed what the pattern is all about. How that everything was threefold, having a most holy place, a holy place, and a court round about, witnessing to the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And then she went on over to show how everything in the universe have that 1, 2, 3 basic principle. Mm-hmm. You see? Then she went on, you see, to my physical body and lined my physical body up by this pattern. Mm-hmm. I heard the pattern explained, but I didn't understand it. But Yahweh chose her, you see, to touch my heart. You see, and she lined that thing up by the pattern and took that thing all the way back home, you see, brought it on this side of the cross and set that thing right in my lap. Mm-hmm. My mind was just blown about a woman couldn't preach. That was the main thing he got rid of. Mm-hmm. For me, you see. Then, at that particular time, Bud was the moderator. Uh-huh. You see, that got rid of that thing. You see,
okay.
About white people. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Secondly, when I went to college up north in Bakersfield, it was the Caucasian folks that literally listened, took care of me. Mm-hmm. I didn't know how to read right. Those folks taught me how to read and how to write. Because I didn't know how to read and write. Mm. You see, without getting to a whole bunch of details, you know, it was those folks that had mercy on me and understood that he just didn't get the basic foundation he should have received before he got here. And they work with me and spend time with me, you see, and move me forward. Mm. You see, but what I found out is what I learned growing up, talking about the Black Power, the Black Panthers, and all that stuff, that they was full of, I'll put it like this, polycom. Okay? That's a very fancy way, a very intellectual way of saying BS. You follow what I'm saying? But at the end of the day, you see, to this day, I'm still in touch with those folks who taught me. And I'm going to tell you something. Everybody used to go over to these folks' house, and at the school I went to, all the Black folks was there, was just there for sports. That included me. Mm-hmm. And what happened, I ended up quitting my basketball team and just became a solid student at that particular time because I realized that's not why I'm here. Mm-hmm. You see, and when I got back down, I really continued to go to class, and that's where, to this day, when they said this is the school of the highest learning, mm-hmm. I understand what they mean. Mm-hmm. I didn't understand it then. Mm-hmm. The school of higher, in other words, you're not going to get no higher than Yahweh.
Right.
That's right.
Because Yahweh is spirit. Mm-hmm. You see, now I'm getting to what I want to talk about. Mm-hmm. 2 Corinthians. 1 Corinthians 2:2-7. Now, that's my testimony of how I got here. And to this day, I've been here since 1977. That's 40 years I've been in this school. Mm. And I call myself coming down here to refute people and straighten some folks out than get my father, you know, out of school and end up converting me. Mm-hmm. You follow what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. And that's the power of this teaching. Because I'm going to tell you something. We come in here with our earthly concepts trying to understand this doctrine. But there's absolutely no way possible for you to understand this teaching the way you think, the way you feel, what you believe, what you want, what you heard.
Right.
Hold on to that until Shinar will show you something different.
That's right.
And once he shows you something different, then you got to own up to the truth and acknowledge and admit that you were wrong.
That's
because
right.
At the end of the day, we all were wrong.
That's right.
And we all had a concept and a theory and opinion about Yahweh.
Right.
We always thought that Yahweh was up above the sun, moon, and stars. That's what I believe.
Yep.
And I also thought, and when I was in Islam, there's going to be a day of Armageddon. You see, there's going to be this apocalypse where the world's going to go to an end and go poof. You see, and I believed that for years and years and years and years and years. Because I kept looking out there and I never looked within me.
Right. Okay.
So I always thought when the Bible was talking about the world, I looked at the world as out there. I never understood and thought that you are a threefold universal spirit pattern with an immutable spirit abiding within you.
Mm-hmm.
You see, I understood. I didn't know we were earthen vessels.
Right.
I heard we came to the earth, but when I come down here, I found out the origin of the earth itself.
Yeah.
And the universe and all things therein, including the angelic hosts.
Mm-hmm.
I found out who I am. And I found out this. You see, that I'm the only one in reality that exists. Whether you here or whether I'm here, it doesn't matter.
Right.
The only person who needs saving is me.
That's right.
The only soul I need to be concerned about is my own.
That's right.
Because I can't save you.
You're right. Yeah.
You see, I wish I could.
I know.
You see, but I can't. You see, now we had a song that was read. I call 1 Corinthians 2:7, right?
Yeah.
But before you get that, we're going to head back. Go to Revelation 3:20. And then we head back over there. Because see, Yahweh had a purpose. A definite purpose and a pattern and a plan of salvation. And what we don't want to be deceived is by our own thoughts and our theories and opinions. That's why we have this chart over here that you have an egotistical misdirected personality.
Yes, sir.
Meaning that you have a concept and a theory about what the earth is, about who you are, about where you come from and where you're going, and about what death is.
Right.
And we come here to find out about our origin. Where did we come from?
Mm-hmm.
What spirit is in my body? Why do I act a fool? Why do I lie? Why do I deceive? Why do I cheat?
Mm-hmm.
You see? Why do I pretend?
Right.
Why do I do these things? You see? And you find that because you have an image that you're trying to uphold.
Mm-hmm.
We all do.
Sorry.
In one way, shape, or form. All of us. You see, and what we want to do in the school is to shatter that image that you've embraced and take on the body, you see, or the body or the principles of Yahshua the Messiah.
Mm.
That's what this thing is all about. So when you read over there in the book of Revelation, which was written by John, and John, the apostle, is confirming Moses' vision. You see? And whatever Moses saw, I'm letting you know John saw the same thing. And the conditions were the same with the Apostle John as they were with Moses right here. Moses was caught up in a high mountain, you see, and Yahweh showed him a rerun of the creation, how it came in by the pattern.
Mm-hmm.
Likewise, all an island is a mountain sticking out of the water. So just as Moses was done on top of the water, top of the mountain, so is John on the Isle of Patmos.
Mm-hmm.
Remember, the principle remains the same, but the manifestation changed.
Right.
We got an island here, we got them out here. They're both mountains, one's in the water, and this one's in the desert.
Yeah.
The principle remained the same, but the manifestation changed. That's what the founder taught us.
Mm-hmm.
You see? So here's John on the Isle of Patmos, and look, he's exiled out here.
Mm-hmm.
You see? And Yahweh caught him up, and he saw the purpose from the end
all the way back to the beginning. Mm-hmm. And let me say this. Some folks just say, well, why did not John write about the Genesis? He would have, but Yahweh told him not to write. Mm-hmm. Because Moses already wrote it. And I'll prove that in a minute. Read, please.
Revelations 3:20.
Read on.
Behold, I stand at the door and knock.
Now he says, I, talking about the Messiah, I stand at the door and knock. So first thing we think about is the door like right over here, mm-hmm. or the doors at our home. And he's not talking about that. Isn't that right?
Right.
Yahshua Messiah says, I am the door.
Right.
Mm-hmm. That's what he said. I am the door. Mm-hmm. Read, please.
If any man hear my voice and open the door, I will come in to him and will sup with him, and he with me.
Now listen, if you hear my voice, open up your heart, open up the door, be still. Because listen, I am made up of these attributes of intelligence, wisdom, and knowledge, beauty, love, justice, foundation, power, and strength. I am both masculine and feminine within myself. I am, as Yahweh, the Father, the parent substance. And it is me who takes on a shape and form, you see, as Yahweh Elohim, you see, or manifest as Yahweh Elohim, you see, or incarnate as Elohim, who is the Son. Mm-hmm. So me being the Father, now I'm functioning as the Son of Yahweh, or I am Yahweh in his sonship degree.
Right.
And it's me, you see, who's going to manifest, you see, as the entire universe. Meaning the physical creation as well as the angelic host. That's what I'm going to do. But listen, I'm going to reveal myself to Moses, but I got to have witnesses. So therefore, I'm going to also reveal myself to the one John. You see, because it is me who is Yahweh, listen, in shape and form, who took on, who manifested in the flesh. And let me say this. Yahweh is the mind of Yahshua the Messiah.
Right,
carrying out the will of the Father.
Right,
and giving you something to look at from a natural physical standpoint to take away your excuse about who he is. So the thing that he did in the beginning, you understand what I'm saying? He had to also do at the end. So just as the Spirit is moving on the face of the deep as it is walking the water, therefore I have to walk the water. You follow? For you. Mm-hmm. To look at, to know that it is me.
Mm-hmm.
You see, but stand at the door. Look, if I stand at the door and knock, read on.
If any man hear my voice,
read.
And open the door, I will come in to him,
read.
And will sup with him,
now,
and he with me.
Now, if you, I'll come in, talking about the Messiah, I'll come into your heart and in your mind, and I will sup, I will have dinner. Mm-hmm. I will dine with you. That's why he said, then went up Aaron, Nadab, and Abihu, and 70 elders, you see, and they saw the Elohim of Israel, right? And there was under his feet, as it were, a paved work of the sapphire stone, and the body of heaven in its clearness. And upon the nose of the children of Israel, what? He laid not his what? His hand. You see, and the children, and they did what? They did what? Eat and drink.
Mm-hmm.
Not soda pop, not chips, not tuna sandwiches, you see. But you know what? These folks did not eat and drink the stuff that Moses had. You see? Because, see, their hearts was not open. But Yahweh touched his heart and pierced through the veil of flesh and showed him how the creation came in by the pattern.
Mm-hmm.
The origin of the creation and the origin of the man. And showed him how he himself, as Elohim, took up residence in this man called Adam. Keep reading to the end. Read on.
To him that overcometh will I grant to sit with me in my throne.
Now listen, he had overcome, listen, his egotistical misdirected personality. Your image. What you don't want to let go of.
And some things are hard to let go.
Mm-hmm.
The flesh is hard to let go.
Oh, yeah.
It is rough as hell.
Yeah.
Sometimes you want to let it go and say, I don't think so. Mm-hmm. Yahweh has provided on a hill. See, there got to be a word of this adversary.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
You see, y'all know how some folks been married for 25, 30 years. One wants out. The other one will stay in. Then sometimes the other one stay out. The other one stay in.
Mm-hmm.
And one person put 95% in. And another person put 5% in. But that 5% is strong enough to hold on to that 90.
That's right.
Mm-hmm.
Or sometimes it's 10%.
Yes.
But that 10% is strong enough to hold on to that 90.
Mm-hmm.
You always set that thing in. And then sometimes, you know, And you got to be in it together.
But
when you're in it together, you're going to be fine. If one's in and one's out, the manifestations are there. It's obvious. The signs are there. The manifestations are there.
Mm-hmm.
You see? So what I'm trying to say, you can't have one foot in and one foot out, because then you're going to be exposed, because Yahweh is revealing himself to his sons.
Mm-hmm.
You have a question?
Oh, okay. Okay. But if you do, you hold your hand up, I answer. I guarantee you that.
Yeah.
Now, read on, so we can get on with this. Read.
Even as I also overcame and am set down with my Father in the throne.
Okay. Now, I made one statement. I want to hit it, and y'all get on to the point. Revelations 10 and 4. See, we got new folks around here who've been here for a short time.
Mm-hmm.
Revelation.
Who don't know the Bible like we do.
Mm-hmm.
However, we're going to make sure that when they get through, they're going to be experts.
Mm-hmm.
Can talk to anybody.
Mm-hmm.
I don't care how many letters behind their name. I guarantee you, anybody up in here, I can take a kid and can confound some of these folks.
Mm-hmm.
You see? Now let's read. Now I said that Yahweh showed Moses. Oh, there's so much. Before I start, go back to, put your finger right there, Doc. Revelation 10 and 4. So pick up Revelation 1 and 1 first, and then read down. And it was a couple of verses, then we'll jump down to 10. Now here's John on the Isle of Patmos. Oh, there's so much. And Yahweh, listen, giving him a panoramic vision. Panoramic means that you see it from all directions. That's what the word panoramic means. And then Moses also read a panoramic vision. And it says, up Elohim to Moses. And it says, up John, up Elohim to John. Now the founder, his vision encompassed John's and Moses' vision.
Yeah.
That's why he says his vision was as better as greater than theirs. But he saw the same thing.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And he declared, listen, the end right from the beginning.
Right.
That's why Yahweh showed him a vision of Moses. Then he also understood what John was talking about. Because
mm-hmm.
The founder told us that John is confirming Moses. Mm-hmm. I didn't know that. I thought Revelation talked about something yet to come.
Mm-hmm.
Every time talking about the rapture.
Mm-hmm.
Come on now, y'all know what I'm talking about.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to rapture up. Let me tell you a little secret, James.
The word rapture is not even in your Bible.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Can you believe it? And let me tell you one more, James, since you're sitting here. The word Trinity is not even in your Bible.
Mm-hmm.
It's a man-made concept. Because some folks don't know what they talk about. Talking about it is a Trinity. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. I'm letting you know it's a unity,
right,
but not a Trinity. A tricycle is not going to function unless it has three tires, but a unicycle just needs one. Isn't that right? That's all it needs. You see? Let's read, please. Let's go. Now listen, pay attention to this. Let's read.
Revelation 1 and 1.
Read.
The revelation of Yahshua the Messiah,
uh-huh,
which Yahweh gave unto him.
Now, God, it didn't say the revelation of John, of Yahshua John. John. It ain't John's revelation.
Mm-hmm.
It's the revelation of Yahshua the Messiah.
Right.
That's what it is. That's who's talking.
Mm-hmm.
That's who's talking right now. That was who talking back then. That's who talking in the beginning.
Mm-hmm.
Let's read, please.
Which Yahweh gave unto him.
Read.
To show unto his servant.
Read.
Things which must shortly come to pass.
Come on, let's read.
And he sent and signified it by his angel unto his servant John.
Now here's John in the agency. That's what he is right here. Alright? And he received a vision from Yahweh himself. And he was the last of the apostles at that particular time. All the rest of them had died off.
Yeah.
But he was the last one.
Mm-hmm.
Let's read. Come on, let's move.
He bore record of the word of Yahweh.
Now he bore record of the word of Yahweh. Let's move on.
And of the testimony of Yahshua the Messiah.
Read on, please.
And of all things that he saw.
Come on.
Blessed is he that readeth, and they that hear the words of this prophecy.
Come on, read on.
And keep those things which are written therein.
There you go. Let's go.
For the time is at hand.
Mm-hmm.
I am the first,
uh-huh,
and the last.
Now some folks said I'm the Alpha and the Omega.
Mm-hmm.
I'm the first and the last. Read on.
The beginning and the end.
The beginning, that's me. Come on, y'all. That's why we say the end of class from the beginning. That's the principle.
Mm-hmm.
Come on, folks. this chart looks like it is linear, but it's a circle.
Right.
When we're in a trap, you know what? It starts at the beginning, but you know you got to make it around, get back to there. I don't care how the track runs, it's one end to the other. Mm-hmm. The end is declared from the beginning.
Right.
Now, jump down to the 10th verse. I made my point. Joshua's talking. Let's read.
10. I was in the spirit on the Sabbath day.
So he said, now look, John said, I was in the spirit on the Sabbath day. What do you mean on the Sabbath? In the rest. Mm-hmm. I was in the cloud. I was caught up in the realm of eternity. Because you ain't going to sing about Yahweh as you let you listen. Unless Yahweh bring you into the Sabbath or into the rest. Mm-hmm. Meaning this. You have to come up, you have to evacuate this body. See, as Moses was in this state of condition, I'm talking about as he laid on the mountain. You see, Yahweh was dealing with his essence.
Right.
His being, his intelligence, his wisdom, his knowledge, his attributes, or his attributal makeup, which is him. Everybody have an attributal makeup in this room. I'm letting you know it is no more than these attributes that was from the beginning, which is Yahweh himself, that are eternal, that are beyond the possibility of death. These are immortal principles, and you cannot spot them with negative principle. You might pervert them, but you can't pervert the original and the true intelligence and the knowledge of anything.
Okay.
I'll give you an example. I'm going to get caught up. If you tell a lie, this truth still exists. You with me so far? You get the point, right? Let's move, please.
And heard behind me a great voice.
Now, John says, I heard behind me a great voice.
Right.
Come on now. See, we got these lips up here. You see? Yeah, join the Yahweh speaks.
Mm-hmm.
Within your tabernacle or yours without any audible sound. But it's loud and it's clear.
It sure is.
He speaks to you on a regular basis.
Yes,
but the point is, you want to hear you. You're looking for something grander than who you are. Let's read, please.
Saying, what thou seest, write in a book.
Now here's John. Come on,
and
read.
Send it unto the seven assemblies.
Here we go.
Which are in Asia,
uh-huh.
Unto Ephesus,
uh-huh.
Unto Samaria,
uh-huh.
And unto Pergamos,
uh-huh.
And unto Thyra,
uh-huh.
And unto Sardis,
uh-huh.
And unto Philadelphia,
uh-huh.
And unto Laodicea.
There we go. Let's read on.
And I turned to see the voice.
Now John says, I turned to see the voice that speaks to me, right?
Mm-hmm.
That's me. Let's move.
And being turned.
And being, wait. And being turned. Oh, John didn't just turn. He said, and being turned.
Mm-hmm.
Yahweh grabs his attention.
Mm-hmm.
Listen to me, boy.
Yeah.
I'm going to show you something.
Yeah.
That's what this thing is all about.
Yeah.
You come in here in this class, I'm letting you know you had a divine invitation, not from your friend, but from Yahweh himself. You don't just walk up in here.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Yahweh invited you.
Yeah,
somebody said, well, that's Jacko. Yeah, Jack Yahweh. The point, you don't see him. Because the mystery is hid.
Yeah.
You see? Let's read, please.
And I saw seven golden candlesticks.
He said, I saw seven golden candlesticks. That's what he's looking at. Now, you guys know, y'all heard this thing, that no man can look at God and live. You heard that before?
Yeah.
You heard that before?
Mm-hmm.
If you didn't, I just told you. Read. Now you watch this.
And in the midst of the seven candlesticks.
John's looking at this. Read, come on.
One likened unto the Son of Man.
One likened unto the Son of Man, looking just like Joshua Messiah.
Mm-hmm.
Come on, let's read.
Clothed with the garment down to the foot.
That's what he's talking about. This right here.
Mm-hmm.
Come on.
And girded about the pass,
uh-huh.
With a golden girdle.
Come on, let's read.
His head and his hairs was white like
wait
wool.
A minute. His what?
His head and his hairs was white like wool.
Now, why are you saying that? We got a pattern.
Right.
You guys know that Yahweh took up residence and sat on the cloud.
Mm-hmm.
And Yahweh chose to symbolize himself as what? A cloud. So therefore, guess what?
There you go.
The hair is white like what?
Wool.
Like wool. Mm-hmm. Now, you know, black folks say, see, now God's black. Because wool have, because lambs have nappy hair.
Mm-hmm.
And God the black. That ain't what he's talking about. He's talking about that white cloud sitting on the throne.
Because
your throne lines up, of course, to your head region. And you know, your brain is made up of gray and white matter. That's what he's talking about.
Mm-hmm.
Let's read, please.
As white as snow.
Read.
And his eyes was as a flame of fire.
Now look, John is looking right at his eyes, and I'm letting you know he ain't dead.
Mm-hmm.
He looked right at his eyes, and he lived.
Mm-hmm.
Love free here, there's a reason why. Read on, please.
And his feet like unto fine brass.
Now, you know, folks, and I see that talking about black folks. Because they're talking about his feet is fine brass. Doc, are the furnishings in the courtroom of my father made of brass?
Yep. Yeah.
False gold.
Yes.
The celebrant, I mean, the altar of sin sacrifice made of brass.
Yeah.
The brazen laver made of brass.
Yeah.
And of course, the cup of holy and honor is made of brass. Mm-hmm. And if I'm not mistaken, did it say his feet burn like a what?
Mm-hmm.
In a furnace?
Right.
Yeah. Is there not fire?
Yeah.
Yeah.
On the altar? Yeah. That's what John's talking about.
Yeah.
Not some talking about Jesus is a black man. That is your egotistical, misdirected personality,
there you go.
Complete with theories, concepts, and opinions.
Mm-hmm.
You see, and when you manifest that, you acknowledging that you are a complete damn fool and you don't know.
Mm-hmm.
But you want to fight about it.
That's true.
Let's read, please.
As if they burned in a furnace.
Come on, let's
and
read.
And his voice as the sound of many waters.
Now, his voice as the sound of many waters. We got water, not that, isn't that right?
Mm-hmm.
Get not Yahweh in the beginning. You see, the Spirit moves on the face of the deep.
Mm-hmm.
What do you mean? It moves on the water. So in fulfillment, Yahshua Messiah had to walk the water. Because that's how it was in the beginning.
Mm-hmm.
You understand? Let's read.
And he had in his right hand seven stars.
Read. Now, wait a minute. Seven stars.
Mm-hmm.
Somebody say, see, now I told you God is a man. He got seven stars in the hand. No. If this is Bud in his house, and I take a photo of his kitchen, I'm going to put it right there. I'm going to take another photo of Bud in his living room, I'm going to put him right there. I'm going to take another photo of Bud in his dining room, I'm going to put it right there. I'm going to take another one in his bedroom, I'm going to put it right there. You get my point?
Right.
I'm going to do that seven times. So you're going to see Bud in each photo on seven different times. So therefore, I got seven stars. It's the one man. It's the one Elohim manifesting, you see, seven times to the man Moses. Listen, in the realm of eternity.
Yeah.
All right. Let's read, please.
And out of his mouth went a sharp two-edged sword.
Read on.
And his countenance was as the sun shineth and his strength.
Now, that's good enough. I made my point.
Mm.
Now, Revelations 10:4. My point is that John wrote the same thing. So, he's writing. Let's read. Revelation 10:4. Did you read it? Because we read about the seven thunders, right?
Mm-hmm.
In that first chapter, right?
Right.
Right? And we didn't read about the seven thunders, right?
This is seven stars.
Oh, it's there. No. We read about the seven thunders. And he started naming the seven thunders.
Oh,
he started talking about these nations right there.
Right.
Okay. That's the seven thunders.
Okay.
You see? But it's pointing to the 7 days of creation back up here.
Okay.
You follow what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
Let's read, please.
And when the seven thunders had uttered their voices, I was about to write.
He says, I was about to write. Come on.
And I heard a voice from heaven saying unto me, seal up those things which the seven thunders uttered and write them not.
Why, Doc? Because Moses had already wrote it.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
It's already been documented. Don't need to write that again.
Mm-hmm.
It said, so I didn't want to make that comment. Okay, read out the one. Why don't you verse it more?
And the angel which I saw stand upon the sea and upon the earth lifted up his hand to heaven.
Go ahead.
And swear by him that liveth forever and ever, who created heaven and the things therein are, and the earth, and the things that therein are, and the sea, and the things which are therein, that there should be time.
That's good.
No
that's
longer.
Good. That's good. That's good right there. I was going to make that point. Now, let's head over back over to 1 Corinthians 2 and 7.
2 and 7?
I think I'm on 2 and 7. Let's read on, please. Now, here's the Apostle Paul. See, now we're way down here. We're going all the way back. You see, where Paul received his vision and his revelation. And Paul, listen, is interpreting or translating what Moses is saying.
Mm-hmm.
And the prophet. And he used the law and the prophets as a witness to prove his point.
Mm-hmm.
You with me so far?
Mm-hmm.
Let's read, please.
For we speak the wisdom of Yahweh hidden in a mystery.
Now look, folks, we're dealing with a mystery. We are dealing with a mystery. What are you talking about? What is this creation? Where did it come from? Where are we within the scheme of things?
Mm-hmm.
What's going to happen to me when I die?
Mm-hmm.
Is there another side? What is death? What is soul? What is the spirit? What is it? Mm-hmm. You see, this is the mystery. Mm-hmm. What is the Bible? Is it really true?
Right.
And says who? Mm-hmm. That's what the mystery is. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Who put it together? Why does it line up like it does? Mm-hmm. Why do I behave the way that I behave? Mm-hmm. How is it that my senses control my being, my thoughts, my behavior, my attitude, and my disposition? How come that is so? And how come when I cut you open, I can't see your soul or your spirit? Mm-hmm. How can I, why can I examine that? Mm-hmm. Put it in a test tube, under my your soul mm-hmm. and your spirit. Mm-hmm. That's the mystery, Doc. Mm-hmm. That's what this thing, that's why we here. To get answers to those questions.
That's right.
And I'm letting you know, in a nutshell, your answer is Yahshua the Messiah. Mm-hmm. Somebody said, what do you mean, Yahshua? I'm saying Yahshua is the teacher. Mm-hmm. He is the comforter. He's going to teach you all things.
That's right.
I don't care what it is and what you've learned. It was him who taught you.
That's right.
The problem is you didn't know it was him teaching you.
That's mm-hmm. right.
But he's always been within you. The point is, you thought it was this thing you call a you. Did that mess that up? This thing you call a you. And you have this satanic triad as me, right? Mm. Myself, right? And of course, and I.
Yes.
Like, who the hell that's supposed to be? But you think that's you. Me, myself, and I. All by myself. I'm letting you know, just as you came in alone, like Job said, I came in naked, I go out naked. That's I right. came in with nothing, I go out with nothing.
Right.
You see, and you're going to do the same. I don't care how much wealth you gather on this earth, you're going to be just like Steve Jobs. You're going to go, you're going to come in with nothing, you're going to leave with nothing. Why? Because the end is declared from the beginning. That's why. Mm-hmm. Y'all with me so far?
Yes.
Let's read, please.
But we speak the wisdom of Yahweh hidden in the mystery, which Yahweh had ordained before the ages until our glory.
In other words, he already purposed. He, I'm talking about the Father Yahweh, the bare son. He already declared in the realm of eternity what shall be. Yahweh already foreknew what Moses was going to do. He knew what the man was going to do. He understood what the woman was going to do because it was him who created the adversary.
Right.
You see? And then you run around thinking you know all about a devil. You don't know about no devil. I didn't know about no devil until I come up in here.
You're right.
I thought the same thing. You thought the devil was some type of some monster. And before that, I just thought he was a man or some monster in a red suit with a tail and a pitchfork. Mm-hmm. I believed that for years. And then I said, well, that couldn't be it because that was on cartoons. I caught on to that. So I just thought it was some monster.
Yes.
It never occurred to me that the devil looks just like me, just like you, because the way he operates, Doc, is he have to pervert these attributes, give the appearance that is real, but in reality that is not. Somebody tell you they love you, but they don't act like it. They don't behave that way. All their manifestations suggest that they don't. Mm-hmm. But if you discern spirits by using your intelligence, your wisdom, and your knowledge, the witness is right there.
That's right.
Now, here I'm trying to get me a job. I'm going to present well. I'm going to put on a nice shirt and tie. Mm-hmm. I'm going to go and give a nice, good interview. Mm-hmm. My intent is to rob the bank. Mm-hmm. That's my intent. But I can't let you know that. Mm-hmm. I'm going to be the model employee. You see, on time. You see, make sure that I consult with my supervisors. You see, or my figureheads. Mm-hmm. Letting them know, get my ducks in a row, that I understand the policies and procedures of the, you know, of the bank or whatever it may be.
Right.
You see, and once I get myself in position, guess what? Now I got the keys and I got the codes to rob the bank. I done robbed the bank and gone, nobody see me. And guess what they say? Good couldn't be Joe. Yeah, it was y'all. Because I tricked you. I was looking just like one of y'all. That's the nice thing about y'all. Remember those angels, Doc? When Yahweh, cast Lucifer out, he said he thought he was the one. Then guess what? Yahweh Elohim raised his head. He said, now has come, salvation. The king. I'm talking about our Lord. Because he walked around those angels. They didn't know who he was. Joshua walked around his truck. They didn't know who he was. Joshua's son walked around his truck. They didn't know who he was. Now here you go. Your job, whatever you do, you walk around. They don't know you, Yahweh. They think you're just one of us. Until you start talking about Yahweh, then they want to cuss you out about it because you don't believe in Jesus. Or whatever. Oh, now you're a cult, or whatever the case may be. But they won't disprove anything that you say or refute it. You see, they may attempt to refute it. They may disagree with it. And that's all they better do is disagree with it. But prove me wrong. And then we talk. You follow what I'm saying? Let's move on, please.
Which none of the rulers of this age knew.
Uh-huh.
For had they known it, they would not have crucified the King of Glory.
I just told you that. All right? If they knew that was God in the body, they would have killed him.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
He made them kill him. Called them names. It's like talking about your mama. You want to fight. Oh, yeah. They made him. You don't touch Joshua unless he give you permission. Mm-hmm. See, John baptized Joshua aside, but it was by permission. He said, suffer to be so now, John, but thus becoming us to fulfill all righteousness. And he said, then, the book said, and then he permitted him. You don't just touch it. And then when he went to kill him, they was right there, boom, next thing he's gone. I'm talking about Yahshua.
Yeah.
You see, that's how it was back then. And it still is that way. But let's read on, please. Let's move, please.
But as it is written,
read.
I had not seen,
now look, folks, as it is written, that I have not seen, or the ear have not heard. Let's read on.
Neither have it entered into the heart of men the things which Elohim have prepared for them that love.
Way back here, folks. You do not understand that until you understand what Yahweh has revealed unto you. You see? Read, please.
For Yahweh has revealed them unto us by his Spirit.
Now look, he revealed himself. I'm talking about the archetype pattern of the universe, which is Elohim, by himself. He's the one doing the revealing. How he's doing it, Doc? He manifested as the first day, as the second day, as the third, the fourth, the fifth, and then he manifests as the man.
Yeah.
You see, he formed the man from the dust of the earth, which he created. And then he himself took up residence in that man. The same way you bake a cake, but you don't see all the ingredients in there. You don't see the salt, the flour, you see, and the butter, and all that. You don't see it.
Yeah.
But you see the manifestation of it, because you can taste the butter. I mean, a good cook can bite into a piece of whatever food that is, and say, got some butter, some vanilla in here, and got some salt. You get my point? You can just start naming all the ingredients, and then go out and make it.
That's right.
I mean, I'm a good cook.
Yeah, sure.
You see?
Yeah.
But you don't see the essence. Mm-hmm. We can bite into a piece of fruit. We don't see the vitamin C.
Right. Yeah.
We taste the sweetness. You see? But we don't see the actual composition of the glucose. Or the, you understand? We don't see that. But we know it is there. Because Yahweh manifested back here.
Mm-hmm.
We don't see the synapses and all those things going on within the physical body. But we know. I'm going to call. Tell me I'm not. Oh, good. I'll turn that off. I'm going to call tonight. Don't worry about it. That was just my sister. That's why my phone's on. I apologize.
Yeah.
All right. You see, I meant to tell him in the beginning, but y'all are going to give me this tonight. You see? Now, let's move on.
For the Spirit searcheth all things.
Now look, the Spirit searcheth all things. Not some. Read.
Yea, the deep things of Yahweh.
Yea, even the deep things of Yahweh. Now, Dr. Kim told us this. That Jesus was back here with Moses. And that was the greatest mystery that was perpetrated upon mankind. That Jesus was back here in the flesh, walking around with Moses. In the personality of Hoshea the son of Nun.
Right.
You see? And then went about to prove it. That's what he did. I'm just going to show you one, but I got to move on because I got to make a point. You see? You see, real quickly, we know that the priesthood, because we got a pattern, isn't that right?
Mm-hmm.
In order to be a priest, how old you got to be?
30 years.
You got to be 30 years old. So guess what? Yahshua was 30 years old. I'll do it this way. Yahshua was 30 years old. Right back. Gosh. He was 30 years old when he entered to his ministry.
Right.
Mm-hmm. I spelled that right. Mm-hmm. Now, how do I know that? Luke 327. I think that's where it is. If it's not Luke 327, it's Luke 323.
Okay,
and it might be 323.
323?
I think that's where it is.
Luke 3:23, and Yahshua himself began to be about 30 years of age.
Now, God, what more can I have to, do I have to say?
Not too much.
What else do I have to say? Here's Yahshua saying, I am the King of Kings, I am the High Priest of High Priests. Now he's about the age of 30. Now he's going to John to get baptized in physical, natural water. Right? Why is he getting baptized in physical, natural water? Because Paul said, be not ignorant how all our fathers baptized in the cloud and in the sea. And in the beginning, Yahweh moved on the face of the deep. You see, and the man himself was inundated in that water. Or Yahweh was immersed in that cloud. So Joshua the son of Nun, when they come through the divided waters of the Red Sea, the question is, how old was Joshua the son of Nun?
30 years.
He had to be 30 years old. Because Yahshua is fulfilling.
Yep.
So he had to be 30. He had to be 30. Mm-hmm. And we know that after Yahshua, ain't gonna go all day. After Yahshua saw get baptized, he goes straightway into the wilderness, isn't that right?
Right.
And how long was he out there, Doc?
40 days.
Mm-hmm. You see, I'm talking about Yahshua the Messiah. 40 days. Mm-hmm. You see? Y'all get the point. 40 days. Mm-hmm. So therefore, when Joshua's son and I come out here, all of Israel come to the divided waters of the Red Sea, and he was baptized in the sea.
Mm-hmm.
When he get out here in the wilderness, how long was Joshua, the son of Nun, with the children of Israel, was out here in the wilderness?
40 years.
Mm-hmm. We got a pattern, folks. Everything has to line up by the pattern. And guess what? You see, when Joshua get over here, how long did he reign over here? I'm talking about Joshua, the son of Nun. How long did he reign over here in Canaan land, folks? It ain't difficult. 40 years. And he died. Isn't that right, Doc? I'm talking about Joshua, the son of Nun. He died at 110 years old. Right? Now, the question is, Joshua, after his death, his burial, and his resurrection, how long did he tarry on earth? It ain't difficult. You got a pattern. You see, all you got to understand is 40 days. Mm-hmm. Isn't that right, Doc?
Yeah.
40 days he cherished. So therefore, that's 110 days.
Mm-hmm. Fulfilling.
He's fulfilling. Because see, what Joshua did, Joshua set it up to come in to fulfill it. Because Joshua is Joshua, and Joshua is Joshua. Yeah. He was here, and he was here.
Right.
You see? Now, 10 days later, you said, you remember he ascended to the fathers among Yahshua, right? And then 10 days later, guess what? Mm-hmm. It's 120, right?
Mm-hmm.
He ascended and be poured his spirit out in the hearts and mind of men. Is that almost right?
Right.
You see? And remember, he died at 110.
Mm-hmm.
But 10 years later, the temple was dedicated. Is that right, Doc?
Mm-hmm.
That was 10 years later. So you got 120.
Yeah.
So, when you see that 120, you got to see Noah preached for how long? 120 years. So that was a fulfillment of that 120.
Yeah.
There was three kings up here in Canaan's land. You see, I'm talking about who reigned 40 years apiece. Saul, David, and Solomon.
Yeah.
Right? Now the total of 120 year reign. So, therefore, he fulfilled that 120. Do you get my point?
Right.
What I'm trying to make here? There's a pattern of operation, and Yahweh is manifesting himself to his sons to see.
Right.
but he's giving you witnesses to look at. So you understand that that was in the Bible, it is so, and we're going to utilize the Bible as a witness for Yahweh himself. All right, now let's move on. That's enough of that. Question, Doc?
Yes, Joshua, 30 years old, then 40 years, he was in the wilderness, and 40 years, he was, 110. What are the 10-year dedication of what temple?
Solomon's Temple.
Solomon's Temple.
Was dedicated 10 years after Joshua's son of Nun died in the wilderness.
I don't think so.
I think so. Because, you see,
Solomon is the one who built the temple.
I think we had this conversation once before.
Once the temple correct me if I'm wrong, the children of Israel left up out of the land of Egypt, you see, in 1490 BBY.
Yeah.
That's right.
And, from the land of Egypt until Canaan's land, and David, who received the divine vision and revelation. You see, he received divine vision revelation, but he could not build the temple.
Right.
Why? Because he was spotted.
Mm-hmm. Right.
He was looking at that woman.
Mm-hmm.
It's, right?
Yeah.
You see? And it was him who told his son Solomon to build the temple.
Mm-hmm.
That was in 480. That was 480 years after the children of Israel left out of the land of Egypt. It took 7 years to build the temple. Isn't that right? Mm-hmm. It took 7 years for them to build Solomon's temple. That was 387. Why? Because they just moved those rocks and the material down the river. Because they had to be an invisible operation.
Mm-hmm.
What are you talking about?
Right.
When you come in, isn't it a quiet, mm-hmm. invisible operation taking place when you come in? So therefore, this principle had to be the same. And after Solomon's temple was completed, it took them 3 years to put the furniture, to make that, and put that on the inside. Is that right?
Oh.
You see? So therefore, that was 490 years.
Set.
You see?
Mm-hmm.
When it was completed.
Mm-hmm.
490 years. Now, 1,000 years later, guess what? Yahshua Messiah shows up on the scene.
Mm-hmm.
1,000 years later, from that 490 years, you see, in fulfillment of this event right here, 4,000 mm-hmm. is 490. Because the conditions are the same. You get my point?
Mm-hmm.
You see, why? Because there are 4,000 years from the fall of Adam all the way down to the cross.
Mm-hmm.
You see? So therefore, it was 480 years, 7 years in the building, and 3 years to put the furniture inside.
Mm-hmm.
That's 490 years. That was the building of Solomon's temple.
Mm-hmm.
And that makes up, you see, what we're talking about, the 40 years. But Solomon did build the temple. That is correct.
Mm-hmm.
Now, can we move on? Where we left off.
But what man knoweth the things of a man save the spirit of man which is in him?
Read on.
Even so the things of Elohim knoweth no man but the spirit of Elohim.
Now what Paul's trying to get you to see is that the spirit that's in the man is Elohim.
Mm-hmm.
The problem is the man don't know that the spirit that's in him is Elohim. He thinks it's him.
Yeah.
This thing you call a Yule went over the other night.
Yeah.
But see what happened is gonna take Elohim to reveal himself, of course, to the man by tearing down those veils, by showing you the witnesses.
Mm-hmm.
You see? See, that's the reason why we had called Siobhan to be given testimony.
Mm-hmm.
Because folks just don't come up here and sit through this teaching. I'm mm-hmm. talking about folks like you.
Mm-hmm.
They look at us and say, I ain't got no business hanging with these folks.
Mm-hmm.
I'm talking about well-educated folks on a regular basis. That's how they feel, some of them. And the scientists don't want to hear nothing we got to say because they don't understand. They don't believe that people have vegetation on the third day and the sun, moon, and stars and come into the fourth. Right. But when they don't understand that Yahweh Elohim is the light of lights, this cosmic light, and he is him that's illuminating the way. And this, therefore, he created, allowed the vegetation to come forth on the third day. But he did put the sun in the heavens on the fourth day, because it was declared back here in the realm of eternity that this is going to be a great light and there's going to be a lesser light. But when the great light comes, he's going to give way to the light to illuminate the world. You see? And if he did not do that, then Yahweh would not be just to his own law, because he is also subject to his own law. So when he gave Israel the 613 statutes, judgments, and ordinances, he himself, talking about Yahshua, had to be obedient to his own law. That's why the book says this: in him was no sin.
Right.
Because sin is the transgression of the law. But in Yahshua, there was no sin. So therefore, he was fit to be the proper sacrifice to atone for mankind's sins.
Right.
You see? Read on down, because I'm going to take a trip up in that garden. Just a minute. Just read on, please.
Now, we have received not the spirit of the world.
Read on.
But the spirit which is of Elohim.
Hold on. Your egotistical, misdirected personality is the spirit of the world. That's all it is, like it or not. You see, that's why I'm going to take a trip up in this garden. You see, and show you how the man failed and why we're in the state and condition that we're in today. Because the man has to fall. Because Yahweh made provisions for the man to fall. You see, that's why he said, men walk as trees. You see, because listen, every fruit on that fruit tree got to fall in order for it to bear more fruit. The man had to plant seed. I said the man had to plant, I thought in the earth.
Yeah.
Right.
I never see that before.
You follow me? To bear more fruit. Yeah. You understand what I'm saying?
Yes.
I don't want to get too graphic, but you get the point.
Yes.
It was set up that way.
Yeah.
Why? Because Yahweh both masculine and feminine within himself. He was equipped to do what? To bear fruit or to give birth. Mm-hmm. So Yahweh, I only both masculine and feminine within himself. Mm-hmm. He was equipped to do what? To bear fruit. So he gave birth to Virgin Mother Earth. Mm-hmm. And as he's moving, talking about Yahweh on the face of the deep, he's impregnating Virgin Mother Earth. Mm-hmm. And this tabernacle, like or not, it has the potential to be male or female. Why? Because we got Virgin Mother Earth, which is no more than a greater and perfect tabernacle. You see, it's the greater, more perfect tabernacle that Yahweh himself built or created and then took up residence in the man Adam and walked around in his own creation. Mm-hmm. We learn that in the school. That's our testimony. Mm-hmm. What we learn in the school, to give all our credit, you see, to Dr. Kinley for laboring for 45 years, preaching Yahshua the Messiah, the death, burial, and resurrection of Yahshua the Messiah, which is by definition the gospel. Mm-hmm. You see? And he always gave credit to who? To Yahshua the Messiah.
Right.
Never to himself.
Right.
He never want to be puffed up. But he also ain't going to let you, he going to be no pushover. Mm-hmm. If you want to try to show, make a point, to try to put poo-poo him, he let you know that he's the king.
Right.
He'll stand up and rise up and say, hey, wait a minute, it ain't like that. This is how it is. Or if a so-called dignitary presents themselves, going to call himself, going to run over us, he says, listen, I'll take that. Because
yeah.
I know how to deal with these folks who think they know. Mm-hmm. And he make a show of them, triumphing over them. I'm talking about the founder. This gospel wounds the three ecclesiastical peace missions.
Right.
This ain't no fly-by-night organization. We know exactly what we're talking about, and we can prove it. If I can't, somebody else can. And there's somebody here, if we don't know, we know somebody who does. And we also have the evidence. Wow, we got a creation, all things therein, and long as you got a physical body, we can prove it. You see, as the founder say, to your satisfaction.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Right. Whatever that might be. To your satisfaction. Mm-hmm. Y'all with me so far?
Mm-hmm.
Now, let's read, please.
We might know the things that are freely given to us of Yahweh.
Just back up to that last verse. Because I want to make a point before I go in that garden.
Now we have received not the things of the spirit of this world, but the spirit which is of Elohim, that we might know the things that are freely given to us of Yahweh.
Go ahead, I made my point. Just move on, please.
Which things also we speak, not in the words which man's wisdom teaches.
Read on.
But which the Holy Spirit teaches.
Come on, let's read.
Revealing spiritual things to spiritual persons.
Spiritual things to spiritual persons.
Mm-hmm.
Now, we take something physical. We call these plates. 1, 2, 3, Father, Son, Holy Spirit. Showing forth that everything is threefold. You see, this chart is threefold. We got the circles up here.
Mm-hmm.
You see, we got the intermediate state. And then we got down here, these plates down here. Showing forth it is threefold.
Mm-hmm.
You see, these circles are linked. See how they're linked? Just like a chain, showing you how these creations are linked. Just like a chain. You can't tell one from the other. There is no line of demarcation saying, oh, we're out of the creative age, now we're in the antediluvian. There's no line separating that. We track time through the man.
Mm-hmm.
That's how we determine the signs and the times. By tracking time through the man. That's what we do.
Mm-hmm.
Keep reading, because I want to make a point. Then we're going to take a trip on that garden. Let's go.
But the natural man receiveth not the things of the spirits of Yahweh, because they are foolishness unto him.
You know what his problem is? He don't want to let go of the flesh.
Mm-hmm.
Why? It looks good and it feels good. And let me tell you right now, it ain't his. I'm talking about the flesh.
Mm-hmm.
You remember that man where he says, he approached Joshua? He said, you know what? I kept the law for my entire life.
Yeah.
My whole life.
Yeah.
Every tear that he said, what am I supposed to do? But he went wrong with, right?
Uh-huh.
So Joshua said, well, why don't you sell all your wealth and your riches and roll with me?
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Man said, oh, man, I can't do that. I love you. I like you.
The test.
But I just can't do that. I like what you're doing. You raising the dead, calling the blind to see, the deaf to hear, the deaf. But I can't, I'm sorry. I can't do that. Then he said, unless you drink of my blood and eat of my flesh, you can have no parts with me. The folks say, wait.
Yeah.
I like what you're doing, but guess what? I ain't drinking your blood, and I ain't eating your flesh. He was never talking about that, Doc. Is that almost right?
Right.
Well, he's talking about the words I speak, their spirit, and I am their life. Because he says, I am the bread. So he put bread in the pattern, because the priest, who is a type of Yahweh Elohim, or the priest's offering, he had to partake of the sustenance that was on the table of showbread.
Yeah.
So therefore he had to say, Yahshua, I am the bread.
Mm-hmm.
And in that we got light in our pattern, you see, and listen, the light burned all night and the sunlight illuminated the tabernacle during the day.
Mm-hmm.
So therefore he was qualified to say, I am the light, because he's the one that put the light there.
Yeah.
You see, he says, I am the door, because he's the one that's going to allow you to see anything.
That's right.
He's going to either put a veil up, I'll say like conceal himself, or he's going to reveal himself. And I'll show you that in a minute too.
Mm-hmm.
Talking about Yah. So therefore, he says, I'm the door. That's why we say, I stand at the door and knock.
Mm-hmm.
If any man hear my voice, you know what? Let me in, I'll come and I'll sit with you. We're talking about no doggone door over there. We're talking about a principle.
Right.
That's what we're talking about. So therefore, we got an altar of incense. That's the intercessor. It's the mediator. Because in our pattern here, remember, Moses would talk to the people. Because Moses would talk to Yahweh.
Right.
And Yahweh would go back, and then Moses would go back and tell the people what Yahweh said.
Mm-hmm.
You got my point?
Mm-hmm.
You got to see that in every place. Yahweh talked to Noah, told him what he's going to do. So Noah went and told the people.
Right.
The people poo-pooed him. He said, that's fine. I'm going to still build a doggone ark.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Y'all can help me if you want. But they never saw rain before. So guess what? At the point of time, Noah prevailed.
Mm-hmm.
And let me tell you something. Yahweh shut that door.
Mm-hmm.
You get my point? So therefore, we got a pattern. Now you know, since I didn't went this far, see, they have a sacrifice. Y'all know he's the sacrifice. He was the only acceptable sacrifice that Yahweh prepared. Listen, way back here in the realm of eternity, before the foundation of the world. So there, and you guys know about the water, right? And the spirit moves on the face of the deep. So we got a pattern. That's why we say blood, water, spirit, or death, burial, and resurrection.
Mm-hmm.
You see, and the oil that's in the cup is a type of spirit.
Mm-hmm.
This is elementary stuff. You see, but the point I'm trying to get you to see, that is Yahshua. That's why he said what he said. And then you got these veils here. Blue, purple, and scarlet. And I'm letting you say no right now. They beat him. And they beat him. And they beat him. And his skin looked like yours when you get your butt whooped. Blue, purple, and scarlet. Got bruises all over. Come on. You get my point. Get your butt whooped. Blue, purple, and scarlet. They beat it. So therefore, there had to be a veil up here. You see? And then, you see, the Ark of the Covenant, you see, which is step number 7, because the gate, you see, is one. Mm-hmm. And Doc, he had to go to John to get baptized, so he had to enter to the gate. Mm-hmm. So coming to the, he is sacrificed, but he had to come to John first. Before you get baptized, you got to wash the sacrifice, then get on that altar. Isn't that right?
Yeah.
So therefore, we got principles. And listen, Yahshua Messiah himself, he is walking up. He's walking up and down through the ages and dispensations. It is him, always been him. So therefore, when you see the throne here, see, in the midst of the mercy seat, you got the Ark of the Covenant. I mean, the table of stone. Why? Because he himself, he is spirit law personified. You see, you got 3 laws on one side and 7 on the other. You see, I'm just trying to show you the witnesses that Yahweh made manifest on the earth for you. Because when Yahweh purposed the purpose, he purposed it with you in mind. Knowing you that you would not understand him in his abstract state. So therefore, he gave you a physical manifestation to look at. Because he knew you would believe that. So when he formed the man from the dust of the earth, he just drew the woman out because he too is both masculine and feminine within himself, because Yahweh is both masculine and feminine within himself, because Yahweh himself is both masculine and feminine within himself. So when he brings the man in, you know, he don't take the male-female principle away from him because he got a Y chromosome and an X chromosome to plant either seed. Mm-hmm. However, the woman don't have either seed. She just got one seed. You see, or I'll say it like this. One egg, which is an X chromosome, that only produced a girl. But guess what? The man cannot give birth to no girl or no boy. But the woman has the potential to give birth and to come through her birth canal, a male or female. So there's things that you can do that he can't do, and likewise, you can't do things he can do that you can't do. Like unto the angels. We can give birth, they can. You follow me? We can hug one another, they can. You get my point? But they can love you though. You get my point? And they can comfort and they can soothe you. Talking about the angelic host. I ain't gonna get into that. Now, have you made it to the last verse yet?
What?
Have you made the last verse in Corinthians?
The last verse?
The last verse. And we're almost there. In 1 Corinthians, 2. And it was like 16:7, the last verse.
Oh, 16.
That's what I want.
Okay. For who hath known the mind of Yahweh, that they may teach it, but he who have the mind of the Messiah.
So you got to have the mind of Messiah to teach anything, teach anyone about Yahweh himself.
Yeah.
Now, Exodus 24:1. Matter of fact, pick up Genesis 1:26 and hold it right there. Now, when Yahweh appeared to Moses at the burning bush, you follow me? Moses did not know who he was at that time. Only thing he knew, he's a Hebrew. Well, he did not know that he had the Holy Spirit. But he was anointed way back here in the realm of eternity. So when he appeared down here with Moses, was reared up in Pharaoh's household, and the book says this, when Moses was born, right, it was pleasing to Elohim. Isn't that what the book said?
Uh-huh.
We just let you know, if Elohim, Joshua's son of Nun, he was down there, it was pleasing to Elohim.
Uh-huh.
You see, however, Joshua's son of Nun did not show up until 10 years after Moses left. But it was pleasing to Yahweh because he had already purposed back here, you see, in Canaan's land, with Abraham, his seed shall go down to a land and know not of and be evilly entreated. But at the appointed time, you see, he's going to bring them out and they're going to come out with great substance. But they're going to be down here for some 400 years. You with me so far? However, Joshua, the son of Nun, he showed up you could correct me if I'm wrong, Dom. He showed up at the end of the 400 years. You see? Talking about Joshua's son and Nun. Right. So therefore, the promise that was given to Abraham, you see, the Abrahamic promise was 430 years before the giving of the Mosaic Law. That's why that's up there. Mm-hmm. Because he showed up, talking about Joshua, at the end of the 400 years. Mm-hmm. Now, we just talked about Joshua, so therefore, he was 30 years old, of course, when he went down here through the bottom waters of the Red Sea. Y'all with me so far? Mm-hmm. So therefore, it is Joshua, son of Nun, who is now made manifest, you see, back here with Moses, as Elohim, who gave Moses the Holy Spirit.
Right.
So you got Elohim, you see, as Joshua, son of Nun, and the Holy Spirit, you see, is in Moses. So those two have to go up into the mountain. Did somebody grab me?
Mm-mm.
I feel like something grabbed me. You sure?
Yeah.
Okay. Anyway. Yeah, pull my hand. Anyway. I apologize, but this scared the hell out of me. Something feel like something's grabbed me, and it was grabbing the stick. But anyway, to make the long story short, these two go up into the mountain. And as they're going up into the mountain, you see, Moses, I'll say it like this, Joshua, son of Nun, who is Yahweh in the body, invites Moses up into the mountain.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And Moses had no idea what he was going to see. He just thought he was going up here to get the table of stone. Because this was a phenomenal cloud. It was a pillar of fire by night and a cloud by day. A phenomenal cloud.
Right.
Yeah. You see? So when he gets up here, I'm talking about Moses, Yahweh blacks Moses out. The same way you go to bed and you go out cold. Mm-hmm. Now, folks, come on, you got to admit this. That is the closest thing to peace you're going to ever experience in your life.
Right.
Right.
To lay down and fall asleep, not conscious, mm-hmm. and waking up knowing that you were asleep.
Mm-hmm.
But the rest and the peace that you experience, you cannot describe what that sleep felt like when you are in what we call REM sleep.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Why? Because when you're in that state, it is incomprehensible, it is inscrutable, and it's indiscernible. Mm-hmm. You cannot describe what it feels. The only thing you can describe what it feels like to wake up.
Yeah.
Because now you're waking up. But in the midst of sleep, it is as if you do not exist.
Mm-hmm.
That's what Moses was. He was on the mountain. Mm-hmm. And he was not conscious of the earthly realm, just like you're not conscious of your bed or your physical body.
Mm-hmm.
But as Yahweh, you see, began to reveal himself to the man Moses, he's caught up somewhere between sleep and being awake. But he was conscious of his essence, his intelligence, his wisdom, his knowledge, his beauty, his love, his attribute makeup. He's conscious of that. Talking about Moses.
Mm-hmm.
And Yahweh began to deal with the essence of Moses,
right,
or the makeup of the man. Mm-hmm. Not that carnality. I'm talking about the idol that he was worshiping down here.
Right.
You see, he was dealing with his very essence. And he took that essence and he walked down through the ages and dispensations with Moses, showing him, listen, the origin of the earth, the origin of mankind, where the sun and the moon and stars came from, as he, listen, Yahweh became the first day, the second, the third, the fourth, the fifth, and the sixth day. And Moses was able to look at Yahweh Elohim, look at the man, Adam, and look at Yahweh Elohim and write that the man is made in his likeness after his image.
Mm-hmm.
Now read Genesis 126. Now, it's already been dropped. Well, you got time right now. Moses wrote the Genesis. In order to have a Genesis, you got to have an Exodus first.
Mm-hmm.
How are you talking about? You got to come out your mother's womb first to have a beginning on earth.
Right.
That's the only way I can explain that.
Right.
Because your beginning, I tell you right now, it ain't in your mother's womb.
Mm-hmm.
It's when you come on the earth plane. So you're manifesting in the earth plane, just like Adam was formed from the dust of the earth. Virgin Mother Earth.
Yeah.
You follow me? And when he formed the man, it is Yahweh Elohim that takes up residence in Adam, just just like the Spirit takes up residence in you.
Mm-hmm.
And just as Yahweh gave Adam a name, your parents, the parents, they give you a name.
Mm-hmm.
And he placed in a land, come on Adam, he know not of. Just like you placed in a land, you know not of. Mm-hmm. Come off the earth.
Mm-hmm. Right.
You see? And listen, Yahweh set this man up, listen, to fall. You got to see Adam with fault. I'll say like, without fault, then with fault.
Okay.
All right? You have to see him that way. We all have experience. When we come in this earth plane, I'm talking about us. Mm-hmm. We have committed no sin, no transgression when we get here.
Mm-hmm.
We haven't violated any laws, any principles. I'm talking about when we manifest on the earth plane.
Mm-hmm.
We're innocent babies.
Mm-hmm.
Holy and innocent, just as Adam came in holy and innocent.
Mm-hmm.
Now, Yahweh set this thing up for the man. And the book says this. Let's read Genesis 3:1-26. Let's go.
And Elohim said, let us make man in our image after our likeness, and let them rule over the fish of the sea,
mm-hmm.
and over the birds of the heavens.
So he gave dominion. Let's read.
And over the cattle, and over all the heaven.
Read on.
And over every creeping thing that creeps upon the earth.
This before we move forward. When he said, let us make man, he's not talking about the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. That's not what he's saying.
That's right.
That's how Christianity explained it.
Mm-hmm.
Let us. No. I'm letting you know. It was Joshua, son of Nun, who was narrating the Genesis to Moses.
Mm-hmm.
And it's also Joshua, son of Nun, who gave Moses the Holy Spirit.
Mm-hmm.
And he's narrated Genesis. That's why he says, let us.
Mm-hmm.
Thus becoming us to fulfill all righteousness. And that's in your textbook.
Mm-hmm.
Because it was the Holy Spirit, you see, in John, and the Holy Spirit, you see, in Moses.
It's in the book.
Mm-hmm. In Joshua. And therefore, it was the Holy Spirit that was in Moses, and listen, it was also Elohim in Joshua, son of Nun.
Mm-hmm.
Another way you can look at it, let us, male and female, you follow me?
Mm-hmm.
That us.
Yeah.
Not separate, but as one,
mm-hmm.
if that makes any sense.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Nevertheless, he gave him a and gave him dominion. And the woman was in couch within the man.
Mm-hmm.
So therefore, she's just as king as you are. She has just as much power as you are. You just don't see it.
Mm-hmm.
But I guarantee you, once she get out, you'll see it. I guarantee you that 100%.
Mm-hmm.
So therefore, Yahweh bring the man out and gave him dominion. You see, over the vegetable kingdom.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, over the animal kingdom. You see, but he is in a heavenly state, not place. And let me tell you something. The sun, you don't see in that place. The sun was placed in a zenith. Where is it at here?
Four.
Right there.
Right.
That's another one. There's another one here. My point is, here you have the sun coming down.
Right.
You see, but in that plate over there, the sun is placed in a zenith.
Mm-hmm.
You see, and my point is, it was summer.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You see, and Adam was running around doing his thing. And he only had one thing to do, and that was to do what? Dress the garden.
Mm-hmm.
That's all he had to do. You see?
Mm-hmm.
Now, he named the animals. You see? And when he named the animals, I'm saying, they came two by two. The king and the queen, they come to Adam, and he was like, that's a chicken.
Mm-hmm.
That's an elephant. That's a giraffe. That's a cheetah. That's a monkey. That's an orangutan. And to this day, they still have that name.
Mm-hmm.
But I want to make this real clear. If there was a talking snake back then,
mm-hmm.
there should be a talking snake right now. If there's a talking bird back then, there should be a talking bird right now.
Mm-hmm.
Now there is a talking bird right now.
Right.
But there ain't no talking snake.
Mm-hmm.
If you find it, you're going to be wealthy.
Mm-hmm.
If you find a talking snake.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, you ain't got to worry about nothing. Everybody, you might get killed
mm-hmm.
somebody trying to get to that doggone snake.
Mm-hmm. Uh-huh.
But the point is, here he is, Adam in the garden.
Mm-hmm.
You see? Now, at that point in time, and he had to come down out of that heavenly state. Now, when he partook of the fruit, which we're going to get to in just a second. Matter of fact, go ahead and read 3:1. Let's read it. Go ahead and read it.
3:1.
Here he is. I'm talking about Adam. Looking at that woman.
Mm-hmm.
Approaching that tree. She's looking at the tree. Come on.
Now, the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field.
That's not a reptile.
At me.
He's talking about a man. And in this man I'm talking about the beast man of sin, which is Lucifer. Now, Lucifer means light bearer.
Mm-hmm.
But when he fell, he was called saved. May I have plate 14 real quick? Just put it right on up there somewhere. You see? And he was already here first. Come on, folks. When you got here, all this mess was still going on. Yes. You have a point?
Mm-hmm.
Everything was good. When you got here, you come right into the mess. You get my point?
Right. Mm-hmm.
So therefore, here he is. Now Yahweh cast him out of heaven, which we talked about the other night, because he was what? Iniquity was found. He was puffed up. He was arrogant.
Mm-hmm.
Thinking he's the one. So Yahweh cast him out. Mm-hmm. And it was Michael. I'll use that. Cast him out. He got Lucifer with the 666 on him. Mm-hmm. Now Yahweh did not cast these angels out. They just followed him out. Because
mm-hmm.
they thought he was the one.
Mm-hmm.
And he looked so good. And he sounds so good. Talking about Lucifer.
Mm-hmm.
He looked good, he sounded good, and he behaved the way they wanted him to act.
Right.
So therefore, they followed after his attributal makeup, which is carnality.
Mm-hmm.
I bet you understand that.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
You see? So therefore, here he's been cast. Listen, coming out of angelic invisibility into angelic visibility.
Mm-hmm.
On down into the earth, as we got here, ethereal darkness. And you see the earth, right? That's right there is the earth. But listen, Lucifer is incorporeal. Isn't that right, Doc?
Mm-hmm.
He's incorporeal. I mean, you can't see him, you can't touch him, unless Yahweh reveal him to you.
Yeah.
And I'm letting you know right now, what Lucifer looks like is a perversion of these attributes. He's intelligent, but perverted. He has knowledge, but is perverted. He has wisdom, but is perverted. You get my point?
Right.
Now watch what I'm saying. Genesis 2:14, 2:13. Let's go. Let's read it quickly.
2:13. And Yahweh Elohim commanded the man, saying,
because she was still in him. Read.
Of every tree of the garden thou mayest freely eat.
Uh-huh.
But of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil thou shalt not eat of it.
That's what he told the man. The woman was still in him. Let's read.
For in the day that thou eatest thereof thou shalt die the death.
Now he didn't say when. He said in the day.
Yeah.
That
yeah.
you eat. No, you're going to. It's yeah. just a matter of time. Because I set it up.
Yeah.
You see, if I didn't want you to touch it, I wouldn't tell you about it.
Right.
But since I told you about it, you will touch it in the day.
Mm-hmm.
Let's read, please.
And Yahweh Elohim said,
read.
It is not good that man should be alone.
Read.
I will make a help suitable for him.
So he gave him a help meet. King James says help meet, but you find it means suitable. Read on.
And out of the ground Yahweh Elohim formed every beast of the field and every bird of the heavens.
Now, Doc, if you want to know where the animals come from, they come from the dust of the earth just like the man.
Mm-hmm.
Now go back and read that again.
And out of the ground.
Out of the ground. Come on, let's read. Read on.
Formed every beast of the field.
Come on.
And every bird of the heavens.
And let me tell you something. The spirit takes up residence in them too. But let's read.
And brought them unto the man to see what he would call them.
That was Yahweh Elohim too. That's the point I'm making.
Mm.
Let's read.
And whatsoever the man called every living creature, that was his name.
Okay, read on.
And the man gave names to all cattle and to the birds of the heavens and to all beasts of the field. But for the man there was not found a help suitable for him.
Go ahead.
And Yahweh Elohim caused a deep sleep to fall upon the man.
Read on.
And he slept.
Here he is.
And he took the womb and closed up the flesh instead thereof.
Uh-huh, go ahead.
And the womb which Yahweh Elohim had taken from man made he a woman.
Now here, go ahead.
And brought her unto the man.
So now he's in a deep sleep. Now he presents his bride to the man.
Mm-hmm.
You see, now they're male. Together, they're Yahweh.
Mm-hmm.
You see, now they got to come together to produce an offspring just like it happened back here.
Mm-hmm.
All right? Now, the fall has to take place. Read, please.
And the man said, this is now bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh.
Read.
She shall be called woman because she was taken out of man.
Read on.
Therefore shall a man leave his father and his mother and shall cleave unto his wife, and they shall be one flesh.
Let's roll on.
And there were both naked, the man and his wife,
read.
And were not ashamed.
Read on.
Now the flesh Now the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field which Yahweh Elohim had made.
Go ahead.
And he said unto the woman, has Elohim said, ye shall not eat of every tree of the garden?
Now watch this.
And
he's good. Look, he's good looking. He's good looking. And I'm letting you know, this is a vision. This is going on within her consciousness. But we got him painted here to let you know what's going on within her mind. And she was told not to touch the tree, but now she's looking at the tree. And then he says to her within her consciousness, go ahead, read.
Oh, and the woman said unto the serpent, we may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden, but of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, Elohim has said, ye shall not eat of it, neither shall ye touch it, lest ye die.
Now that's what she said. Now this is what he said. Read.
And the serpent said unto the woman, no death will you die, for Elohim doth know that in the day ye eat thereof, then your eyes shall be open, and ye shall be as Elohim, knowing good and evil.
So he perverted what Yahweh declared. I'm talking about Lucifer. And so go ahead, girl, eat that fruit. I guarantee ain't nothing gonna happen. That's all he's saying. Go ahead, eat. I tell you what. You know what? If you eat the fruit, guess what? You're gonna be as wise as Elohim or as wise as Adam. Because Yahweh, I'll put Adam was Yahweh Elohim. So was she. Now here's the deception. He's trying to make her think that if she eat the fruit, the book says, she'll be as wise as Elohim. Well, wisdom is part of her makeup. So she already had wisdom, but he's trying to make her think she's going to get wisdom when she already had it. That's the deception. So he's taking something physical, made spiritual, to trick her with something physical. Did I say that right? He took something, look, he perverted her mind with something physical.
Yeah.
Making her think she was something that she already was. Read, please. Or she becomes something she already was.
Right.
Read on.
And when the woman saw that the tree was good for food,
she took a look at it.
And that it was pleasant to the eyes, and a tree to be desired to make one wise,
read on.
She took of the fruit thereof and did eat.
Now we do it all the time. We may look at the neighbor and say, well, yeah, she looks good, or so does he. You and mind your own business. And then the next day you may take a look again while they water their yard. And say, that is a fine specimen of a man over there in those short pants and all those muscles. That's what we do. Or, you know, next thing you know, y'all watering together because we neighbors. And you say you're being neighborly.
That's right.
As you watering your yard or your garden, she's watering her garden. You see? However, both spouses are gone now. Come on, y'all know what I'm talking about now.
Right.
You see? But you're being neighborly. And when somebody come on and say, oh, you ain't going nowhere. We just watered our lawn. We being neighborly. But you know good and well, you reckless eyeballs. Because she look good, and you look good. And I'm telling you, when that aroma is in the atmosphere, don't act like you don't know it's there. Why? Because you smell good, and he smell good, and like it or not, sometimes a nice, greasy man who been sweating, you follow me, work, he smells good, and he looks good. And you know how we go and work out when we call ourselves working out, our muscles, we feel pretty good after we done 10, 15 push-ups. Ain't that right?
Yeah.
Struggle, but we feel good when we did it. And we'll think about doing it the next day. But when we do it, we feel good.
Yeah.
And so does she. Call herself getting ready and call himself getting ready. I'm telling you what's going on up here.
Yeah.
You see? Now, got to come down out of the garden. I took something physical to deal with every day to show you what's going on in that garden. That's all I did. You see? And I'm letting you know, that's what's going on. Now they got to come on out of that garden. Just as you looking over there, she's looking over there, she's looking at the tree. Read.
And did eat and gave also unto her husband.
Now she did eat because she said, why can't I eat the tree? I bet you I'll be just as wise as Adam. So she ate it. And when she ate it, I'm letting you know,
nothing happened. However, when she gave it to Adam, he knew better. Read, please.
And he did eat.
And he ate too. Now, I'm going to tell you why he ate. He could not be with that woman if he did not eat. And the book said to be fruitful and to multiply.
Mm-hmm.
You can't multiply without, he can't be with the orangutan.
That's right.
And the gorillas and the baboons couldn't be, couldn't do that.
Mm-hmm.
He had to be with that woman because the woman was made fit for the man. We just read it. Mm-hmm. And he said, she's bone of my bone and flesh of my flesh.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
So therefore, he had to be with that woman. He had to take responsibility for that woman. And he did. The same way you take responsibility for your kids when they do stuff they ain't got no damn business doing.
That's right.
Yeah.
That's what we do as parents.
Mm-hmm.
That was her parent. He gave birth to her, did he not? Likewise, your parents gave birth to you. So when stuff go down, guess what? They got to step up to the plate and take responsibility for your badass kids.
That's right.
Yeah, I said in the Bible, I thought I'd throw that out. About the jackass talking. It ain't no bad word.
Right.
I'm letting you know how it is.
Mm-hmm.
How much time I got, Doc? 2 minutes, 3 minutes. So I can sit down. How many?
A couple minutes.
How many?
You got 2 minutes.
I'll just take one. So what I'm trying to get you to see, you see, now they're going to come out that garden. It's time to get out. I'm letting you know, those two sons, when Adam took the fruit, now you see how the sun moved on down? They're coming on down. You got the sun over here. You see those sun? That sun right there is coming right on down, right? So in fulfillment, when Yahshua had to take off the fast, guess what? That sun had to come on down.
Right.
The book said it turned dark from what? From the sixth to the ninth hour. Did the book say that? Because
mm-hmm.
those two suns had to come right on down. In fulfillment of what happened in that garden.
I
got to get past this. But anyway, I know it's time, Doc.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm going to be obedient. But I got to get back to this because I always stop here. And there's more to this.
Mm-hmm.
Because the bottom line is, this is the reality of what's going on. When you understand this plate,
mm-hmm.
you understand the rest of the thing. Because what's going on here in this garden is going on in your pattern. It's also going on in the wilderness of Sinai. Oh. Hallelujah.
We're going to truly thank the Father for allowing us to hold class this evening. And we'll hold classes every Tuesday and Friday from 7:30 to 9:30. Sunday mornings from 11 to 1. The fourth Sunday of every month we have a Spanish class from 9:30 in the morning to 10:45. So come back and study with us. Bring your friends and all your enemies. All donations will be accepted by our treasurer, Dr. Lloyd Lawless. And not this Sunday, but the next Sunday, we'll be having a business meeting. And I want everybody that's in class to attend. So if you listen on the broadcast, be here, not for that business meeting. Okay, let's stand for the doxology.
Business meeting, we dox Sunday?
Huh?
This Sunday?
No.
No, next Sunday.
Next Sunday.
We got to be in Palm Springs. Now to him that is able to keep you from falling and present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. To the only wise Elohim, our Savior, through Yahshua the Messiah, sovereign. Belong glory and majesty, dominion and power both before all time, now and ever. Let us all say,
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Another great class.
Thank you, God.
Thank you. All right.
Tomorrow, what time are we rolling out? We're going to go to that secretary meeting?
Yeah, we got to rule it out.
Okay.
We're going to leave, yeah.
So,
me and Iggy and Eunice going tomorrow.
Okay?
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm good at that meeting too.